Hello boys and girls, in this video we are going to end up understanding this pretty little picture here. So we can see this sort of plane as the complex numbers, and then we have the complex numbers of unit distance from the center, and the emphasis here on these certain points which are actually rational points. So we have here as a group, you know, multiplication of this unit elements in the complex numbers, the group U1, it's a Lie group actually, one dimensional compact Lie group. And then there is a subgroup of rational points which then actually leave this Lie group properties. I'm reading currently this book on Lie group theory. I did some streams where I'm just reading this, and there's also this Discord reading group going on. In that way, this is sort of an analysis video, Lie group video, but it also has a strong like elementary number theoretical touch, as we will see. So in the sense that it's analysis, and I speak eventually of sequences of rational points whose limit is not a rational point, it relates to the Cauchy sequence video I did previously. By the way, subscribe to the channel. And we are just going to step through these three pages to really try to understand Pythagorean triples, which have an extremely close relationship to these rational points on U1. And eventually then come back to this parameterization. Also relates to algebraic in geometry, with the real numbers, in the sense that while I'm interested in the rational points on this Lie group, most of it also works for the reals, if you want to leave the rational numbers. Okay, so just as a like trivial reminder, Pythagorean triples are natural numbers which fulfill this Pythagoras relationship, right? The easiest one being 3, 4, and 5. 3 squared, 4 squared equals 5 squared. And so here, this is all about squaring stuff. And in this video, we are going to relate it to the group multiplication on the Lie group U1. There is this very like age-old formula on how to generate them. It's called Euclid's formula or Euclid's theorem, where it says if you have certain natural numbers n and m, then you can generate numbers a, b, and c, and these then indeed have the Pythagorean triple relationship. And we are going to see this formula sort of from a different angle. We are going to see the image of these a, b, and c, the images of this function of natural numbers as a square of the multiplication in this Lie group. Yeah, indeed, on this Wikipedia page, you see some examples. I eventually will come back to, like, apart from the trivial example, which I start with, I will also come back to actually generating this example here, this 48, 55, and 73. And on this page, there is actually also talk already about the rational points. Where is it? Let me see. Rational. Yeah, here. So there's a section called the geometry of Euclid's formula here. It already speaks about rational points on the unit circle. So here you already see in which direction this is going to go. Sorry that you don't fully see this. I don't want to shift around the screen recording now, but I mean, you understand here, you have this triangle with the simplest Pythagorean triple 3, 4, and 5. And then, of course, if you take those and divide it by 5, right, you get three rational numbers, 1, 3 fifths, and 4 fifths. And, well, let me see. So these then exactly fit as rational values that lie on this unit circle. So here we have the first indicator that there are actually rational points on this Lie group in this parameterization. By the way, sorry if you hear the humming of the laptop. It's pretty loud for me, but okay. Hopefully it's not too annoying. And here, we are going to end up talking about this sort of, you know, famous parameterization of the circle and how it kind of arises from our consideration. Here you have the picture I showed you before, and so on and so forth. But okay. Just if you're looking into that, in the description box, as always, you find all these links embedded in the text that I'm going to go through. There's also another Wikipedia page with a bunch of other approaches to finding Pythagorean triples. Although, of course, we have this sort of group theoretical perspective on it that maybe is not so much part of this video. There is a separate Wikipedia page on the group of rational points on the unit circle. They use the same picture here. And this is a short article, but they have then one section of a discussion that we are not going to go look into. Namely, they have the discussion how this decomposes using the cyclic subgroups and so on and so forth. So that's also like a more algebraic and less Lie manifold type of approach. And then they also generalize their talk about hyperbolas and whatnot. So far so good. One recommendation, there's also an article on this group, which quickly delves into more advanced topics, but we are really just going to take a quick look at the end when discussing this parameterization of the unit circle and the kind of geometric understanding of the thing. So let's start with the text, right? So this comes in three sections, and there are conceptual jumps. I kind of switch the few points a little bit, sometimes stepping away from the Pythagorean triple discussion to emphasize this group multiplication, right? The starting point here is that we have U1, which can be represented in this known way, where you have the e to the ia, where a is some real number, gives you complex numbers which have norm 1. Now the complex norm is, of course, you take a number and take the real part, imaginary part, square them and add them together. This is just here the Euclidean norm that I also have here for a reminder. Take the square root. So these e to the ia cover all the norm 1 rational numbers, and as you know, if you multiply them, then you multiply the angles and you also multiply the norms, which in this case are just 1. So there's this product in the complex numbers. These form a group, because if you multiply them just with the complex multiplication, then you again have an element of the unit circle. And the cardinality of U1 is, of course, uncountable. It's a group like the real numbers. And we are interested in a discountable group of rational points on this group. And we ask question like, is this a dense group, or how does the multiplication like manifest, and these kind of things. But it's clear that it's really just going to be, the elements are just going to be elements which are also in this Lie group, right? So these rational points are like these Lie groups of complex points cover all points that are also then found in the rational points. They are just a countable number of rational group elements that are subset and subgroup indeed of this. Okay, but so there are, of course, many subgroups of these groups. These are going to be representations, for example, of finite subgroups. So just to highlight that, and then draw the distinction between these finite subgroups, some of these examples anyway, in the group of all rational points. Let's have a quick look at this Wikipedia page for the dihedral group, right? So these are the group of symmetries of a regular polygon, and here are these pictures that help you understand this. So you have this one representations where you have this kind of six corner polygon inscribed into the circle, and you have okay the dihedral group also has this like various symmetries, but I basically pull up this picture for highlighting these six complex numbers and understand them as a representation of the cyclic group, right? So you have the six numbers which you can multiply just as elements of the complex plane, just as complex numbers, and they will also just form a group. They are the just six element group, and now as a representation in the complex plane, I might ask, what are the coordinates of these things, right? And so, I mean, it's pretty clear here. If the circle has length 2 pi, then these points lie at multiples of 1/6 of 2 pi, right? So it's e to the I times 2 pi divided by n times 6, right? So for example, if you look at the first point here, this set 1, this will be e to the I times 2 pi divided by 6, right? This is this angle. The angle is a little bit like the arc length of this red line here. It's a little bit more than 1. It's exactly 2 pi divided by 6. And here I have this Wolfram Alpha page where I just computed. So this is the x coordinate. This is the y coordinate. So the cosine of 2 pi divided by 6 is this length from 0 to the x point under this, and the sine is this. So it's clear from the picture that the cosine, like the x coordinate, will be roughly 1/2, and the y coordinate will be close to 1. And indeed, if you look at that, then we see we see that indeed the first coordinate is 1/2, is exactly in the middle of the between 0 and 1 on the x coordinate, and the y coordinate is almost 0.9, and in using the square root sign, it actually is the square root of 3 divided by 2. So again, this here we go from 0 to 1/2, this is 1/2. And here is the square root of 3 divided by 2. And the point I want to emphasize, why I emphasize, is that we have a representation of the cyclic group on the unit circle as a subgroup of U1, if you will, right? It's just the finite points. And the coordinates of those are, however, not rational, right? This is a finite subgroup whose coordinates in this representation is a rational x coordinate for this point, but this thing is actually not a rational number. So that means that this point is not at the same time in U1 and in the rational plane, Q squared, if you will. This is the sort of group we are not interested. This is not going to be in this representation going to be correspond to an element of the rational point group. So the subgroup here was the cyclic group, right? And this is also like a little bit the more discussed, the relationship between the rational point group and the cyclic groups in this Wikipedia article that I showed you on the rational points, right? So there's this more algebraic discussion, but again, we are coming from the U1 perspective in this video. In this video, when I will write this, the norm sign, I just mean the square root basically of a squared plus b squared. I can also understand this as a function of natural numbers by considering the norm squared, right? The, if I write norm squared also in the natural numbers, this is just going to be the sum of the natural numbers squared. And here's what I already discussed, right? So there are certainly some rational points in U1. I can also write this like Qi, right? This two-dimensional vector space over the rational numbers. It's obvious that there are some rational points. For example, the number 1 is in this plane, and the number I is also in this plane. These are rational points in this object, which are at the same time part of this representation of U1. But then, you know, there are also more rational points than just these four. There is, for example, 0.6 on the x-coordinate and 0.8 on the y-coordinate is clearly a rational point because, the expansion ends here. And this is just 3 over 5 and 4 over 5. This is a rational point in the plane, which I might also write this kind of suggests how it to what angle it corresponds in this representation of U1. And you get from there to there, of course, just by writing e to the I as with the Gauss formula that you're familiar with. Okay, and so I say U1, but you can also read U1 in its 2x2 matrix representation, so the rotations in the two dimensions. And so U1 is isomorphic to SO to R. And if I consider just the subset of the intersection of SO to R or U1, whatever you want to call it, with these rational points, then I get a group. It's easy to see that it's a group because the inversion is just complex conjugation, and this leads these rational points to rational points, and the multiplication of the complex number multiplication is also like this very algebraic operation that we are going to deal with more in the video. And so this is indeed also a group, and I'm going to call this SO2Q. So this is the standard name for that. Okay, so having established that, we want to find out the relation to all this like ancient Euclidean mathematics, but we want to emphasize this group perspective, this thing which is a subset of the Lie group. And so the first part is now going to looking at the multiplication abstractly, right? So first, before I even get into that, let me just again state the obvious, more or less obvious from the discussion so far, this relationship even between the Pythagorean points and these rational points, right? So if we have a Pythagorean triple, which I write here as some natural number u1 squared plus some other natural number u2 squared, and if it's a Pythagorean triple, that means there's also a third number v, such that this equation holds, right? On the Wikipedia page, this was a, b, and c. This is a Pythagorean triple. Then we can divide on both sides by v squared, and then we get this point on the irrational numbers which has Euclidean norm 1. Euclidean norm 1 really just means that it is a Pythagorean triple here, because the norm is exactly like this, taking the square here, right? So u1 divided by v and u2 divided by v, if you take the norm of that, then if and only if this relation is fulfilled, this has norm 1. And we can also go in the other direction. If I give you a rational point with norm 1, then you can find some common, a multiple of the denominator, and you multiply the point by this scale, you multiply it, multiply it by a factor, then you get two natural numbers, which when squared will be whatever you divide, multiply it by, right? You can go in both directions, of course, but there are more Pythagorean triple than these so-called primitive ones, because if you take this relationship and multiply all side by 7 squared, then you still have a new solution. Okay, Yeah, okay, and now comes the point where we take a step back and we just look at the complex plane multiplication, and I'm going to even take it a little bit more abstractly and see how the formulas that also pop up in the Euclidean theorem, Euclid's theorem, also they arise. Okay, so we take a step back. We're just going to look at an abelian ring. So we have multiplication and addition. Everything is abelian. The first thing I want to point out, because we will see a sort of generalization of that, if this is the abelian ring and you multiply any two elements of the ring and square it, then because it's commutative, it's abelian, this is the same as multiplying the individual factor squared. Okay, we're going to use this later. Now, given this ring, define another binary operation, another group operation. It's very trivial group here, algebraically speaking, on these R squared. So we are going to view R squared now as this space on its own where we have points. Of course, eventually we're going to zoom in on the rational points in the complex numbers. And we define this operation, which will be akin to the complex number multiplication, right? The complex numbers are tuples, and there is a complex number multiplication which takes two such tuples and gives you another tuple, and this is what this bullet here represents. I will call this this symbol, because it's a LaTeX name, I will just call it bullet. So this multiplication is defined like so, and this is really just what you also have with the complex numbers, right? So if you use the imaginary unit and you take a number x1 plus y1 times I, and you multiply two such complex numbers, you get also that. But here I take a step back, define it abstractly. This is my operation. And this generalizes the multiplicative structure on R, in the sense that if I identify Q1 in R with just Q1 and the second component just left zero, then this new multiplication, the bullet multiplication, just reduces to the multiplication that was already defined on the ring, right? In this sense, the ring embeds into this. This is similar to how the complex numbers are the reals times the reals, plus some operation, and the multiplication of complex numbers on the real x-axis reduces to the multiplication on the reals. And now the interesting thing, though, is that this has this nice property that which might not be as obvious from the start. Namely, if you take any two points, like, you know, x1 y1 would be the first point, x2 y2 would be the second point, and you take these points and multiply them, you get these sort of components called x3 and y3. And you take those and compute this norm squared, then this norm squared actually factors into those two things. And this just works on this abelian ring. Yeah, I can plug in here this multiplication. I computed this in word form alpha in advance. So here's what I do. I take this is just what I get from the multiplication. And I compute the norm of the multiplied points, and the factor into the norm squares of those things, right? And really, in the complex numbers, this is just a statement that the norm of the complex numbers squared is, or the norm of the multiplication of the complex numbers is the multiplication of the norm, right? So, but nonetheless, this, or everything here, mirrors the field of complex numbers, although I just made use of the fact that I'm dealing with a abelian ring here. And so we have this relation, right? This is, like, again, I want you to stare at this for a second and consider that it might not be, like, completely obvious, right? Here on this side, you have the outcome of this operation, and this, a function of the components somehow factors nicely, okay? And what is interesting now is that we can use this to generate solutions of equations from previous equations, right? What do I mean by that? Okay, let's say f is any multiplicative function, any function which has this sort of property, where this is basically a sort of homomorphism of the multiplication. So for example, this is the case for monomials, right? So for example, if f is, take the input and take the seventh power, then the seventh power of v times omega v times w equals the seventh power of v times the seventh power of w, if everything is abelian anyway. And so what is it, what does that like give us? The funny thing is now that, let's say we have this equation, right? The norm squared of u equals f of f. So this is an equation given to us, and we are tasked to find solutions. And now the interesting thing is that because of this structure and how this factors with this this binary operation, which is happens to be the same thing as complex numbers, we can actually use this to find new solutions from old solutions for these equations, whatever this f, the multiplicative function, is. Yeah. This is because, let's say you have two solutions of this equation, right? You have some ring, some abelian ring. You're tasked to find solutions for this. Let's say you have two solutions. Well, given two solutions that fulfill this equation, you can take the solutions and multiply them together with this bullet multiplication operation. Okay. Then you get a third point, which relates to whose components relate to the old components as such, right? And then this new point will also fulfill this equation, and you know how even to compute this, like these u's are going to be the new point that you obtained by multiplying the old points, and they will equal f of and you know also what v is, namely v is going to be the multiplication of the of maybe I should have called given this a different name, but you also know what like this new right hand side is, because it's just going to be the multiplication of the right hand sides of your previous solutions. Okay, so I hope this makes sense. Let me maybe just for the sake of it say it again, just so that you see what is not obvious here, right? So you have this multiplication that you define on this abelian ring, so you can take two points to another new point. And the nice thing about this multiplication is that the output of this multiplication, has a nice algebraic property to the multiplication input. So here you have a function of the first point, namely the norm squared. Here you have a function of the other point, namely the norm squared. And if you multiply those two norms, then you actually get the norm squared of the new point, right? And so if you are tasked to find solutions for an equation where it says, hey, the norm squared of, you have to find a point and a third value v, and they have to fulfill the property that the norm squared of the point equals f of this other third value, then if you have two solutions, then because of this algebraic property, if this f is multiplicative, then you can generate more and more solutions, right? You just take the two points that you already have. You have already two solutions. You take these solution points, you multiply them together, you get a third point, and you have to also solve the equation for a third point, because you know how the right hand sides relate to each other. Okay. So with two points you get a third point, of course, then you can generate a sequence of them, right? You can always like multiply these points, so you get more and more points which fulfill this equation. And I mean, you get a sequence. The sequence might be a periodic eventually, but you get from 2 points to a first solution. You get from 2 solutions to a first solution. But in fact, you actually need 1 starting solution, because if you have a starting solution, then a starting point basically, then the point with itself will also be a solution, right? There's nothing that said that 2 solutions have to be like different solutions. So given any solution, points x and y, so in our case this f is just the square of the point, right? So this equation, we are just interested in the one where f is just the square of v. So we are interested in solving the Pythagorean triple equations. And given 1 solution x and y, and you know, whatever the right hand side is, like if x and y are on the left hand side of the Pythagorean triple, then by this relation, we know that multiplying the point with itself will give another solution. So what happens if we multiply the point with itself? Well, we can just, you know, take the definition of this bullet operation and say that the first point equals the second point, then this simplifies a little bit. And what you get is x1 squared minus y1 squared plus for the first component, and for the second component, x1, y1. So you get exactly this. So if you take any point and multiply it with itself, with the bullet operation, you get this sort of thing, right? And here again, I'm just considering the complex multiplication, except I'm not interested in the complex numbers as a field. I don't consider division here. I'm just interested in the natural numbers and multiplying them like they were complex numbers. So this is what my abstraction process that I do here. And of course, here I have an example that you see that as the Gaussian integers, right? The integers in the complex plane, for them, this is exactly what I described here, basically. Okay, and so the fact that this thing is a Pythagorean triple, that this thing in itself actually happens to always fulfill the desired relationship of a Pythagorean triple, is clear from this basic equation, right? It might be easier to read it from the right side to the left. So you take the norm squared and square it again. So x squared plus y squared squared. If you multiply that out, then it's the same thing if you multiply that out here on this side, right? What happens here is just that get this if you multiply out this thing, then you get 2 times x squared minus, like, I mean, I could write that here, but you get minus 2 x squared y squared, right? And if you add this thing squared, then there's nothing negative left, there's just positive things, and this is exactly what you get if you multiply out this thing. So this is the most basic algebraic equation here. And this shows actually this image here, it is a Pythagorean triple. This formula is also what you probably see. This is basically what you see here, right? So these are these 2 sides. It's immediate to verify that indeed this is a Pythagorean triple. And I think it starts even out like that. Yeah, this is like what they are getting here. And so together this means that having found 1 Pythagorean triple, we can bullet multiply it with itself and we get another one, right? The funny thing is now that we have this way of generating more and more Pythagorean triples. And as we've seen, these can be understood as rational points on U1. And what I do next here is that I formulate this process just as like I this division that gets you from a Pythagorean triple down to a rational point on U1. What I now do is I divide up front and read this bullet multiplication as the multiplication of this SO2Q, as these rational points on U1. So, okay, here again, I write down again the Euclidean norm, and I do this computation here. So if I compute the Euclidean norm and to the power of 4, then this is this thing to the power of 2, right? And by the relation that we just saw, this is that, and this is then exactly the components of this thing, and this thing is exactly the result of this operation of taking a point and multiplying it with itself. So the norm of the result of the bullet multiplication is the norm squared of this point. So in the complex numbers, this would just say that the norm of a complex number multiplied with itself is the multiplication of the individual norms. And so let's define this row. This is just a multiplication of these things where we say, okay, now we take a step away. We say we don't look at the natural numbers, but we allow ourselves to divide and go from the natural numbers into the rational numbers. And then we find, of course, this is really just this embedding of the rational numbers, rational number plane into U1, in that indeed these objects have norm 1. Okay. Also, we are like, this will be relevant later. These objects, anything that is a multiplicative, of course, factors out, right? So if we understand these tuples as elements of a vector space where we can pull out an over factor, then since the norm is linear in a factor from both components, then we have this relation. If we have any k, let's say natural numbers, but also, like, we are only going to use it for natural numbers, but also works with any rational number, not zero, then these over factors also don't matter. Okay, so the Euclid's theorem, this is this theorem, that basically says that indeed all Pythagorean triples are generatable with this formula, but there is some redundancy, right? So it's possible to generate all primitive Pythagorean triples using this, and then the theorem says you actually only need those natural numbers as inputs, which are coprime, and one of them is even, one of them is odd. And so from our perspective here, this is a statement about this map, right? This map understood as a map from natural numbers into the rational U1 points, or SO2Q. Oh, sorry, I should not cover up this text. And the theorem that you only need these coprime numbers where one is even or one is uneven basically tell you something about the surjectivity, namely that all these Pythagorean points, i.e. all these rational points on U1 are found, and that to what extent it's not injective, right? So this for example, this relation says that this cannot be injective, because if you take any tuple of natural numbers and multiply them by 17, then you get the same result. So this is not an injective function. And so here I have this example. You know, we have the numbers 8 and 3. These are they have no common factor, no common prime factor. this is an even number, this is an uneven number. And so by the Euclid theorem, this can be used to generate a Pythagorean triple. And in our language, this means that Pythagorean triples for us are the Pythagorean triples are exactly the using this formula, this left hand side and this right hand side, and then we are supposed to get two numbers which are a Pythagorean triple, right? Again, this is this formula and this formula together give a number which is then a square of another number it's going to be c squared. And in our language, this now just means that given any pair of coprime numbers where one is uneven, the bullet multiplication is supposed to give us a Pythagorean triple. And indeed, you know, you take 8 and 3, you get 8 squared minus 3 squared and 2 times 8 times 3, and we get this value. And this is on the left-hand side of the Pythagorean triple. On the right-hand side is the norm squared. The norm squared is 8 to power 3, 3 to the power 3, and you see these three formulas, these are exactly the one that you also just saw on the Wikipedia page. So are these numbers. And so this is also the example that you see here that I said we will get to. Here, this is this one. And of course, I could play this game also with any number now, right? I could take the number, I don't know, 8 and 15, I guess, would work, right? 8 is even, 15 is uneven. They have no prime factor together. I could plug them into this, multiply them in the complex plane. I take these natural numbers, I embed them into this unit vector. I multiply them together. I take basically the bullet square. And I would get a Pythagorean triple, which just means that the result is again on this rational point on U1, right? And the theorem says then I can take natural numbers and get all Pythagorean triple, i.e. all rational U1 elements in this way. And formally the square root of this point, right? This point I obtained to get this Pythagorean triple, but the square root in U1, would be the square root of this point here would be this thing, right? If you take this and do the bullet operation on it, I would get exactly that divided by 73, right? So I jump around a little bit between the normed and unnormed points, but you get what I mean, right? If I take this and divide it by 73, I get this rational point, this corresponding to Pythagorean triple. The square root of it with respect to the bullet operation would give me this point. And this point actually doesn't happen to lie on, it's not a rational point, right? So even if all Pythagorean triples, i.e. if all rational points can be obtained as a multiplication with itself of some point, this point where they come from on U1 doesn't actually have to be on the inside of these rational points, right? I hope that makes sense also. Okay, a little bit over the place, but I get something to draw on, right? I see a lot of YouTubers now have this big drawing board thing, and then I could actually write on this on the complex plane and indicate where the points lie. But I guess it's you have it in your mind, more or less. Okay, so I already emphasized that because of this direct relationship between the Pythagorean triples and these rational points on U1, we found all these rational points now, right? And with the next formula, we can easily then also see that indeed the rational points happen to be also dense in U1, And why is that so? Well, so remember that above I said that this multiplicative factor on both sides does not give us a new point, right? This was one of the statements that this rho function is not actually an injective function, right? That's why we consider coprime factors to get the primitive ones. Due to that, like if we interpret this function rho, which we defined for positive integers, which is, however, this is, you know, just a fraction, it's just a quotient of this quadratic polynomials. If we allow ourselves to plug in rational numbers, then we see that all these values, rho of x and y, are also obtained as values rho of 1 and this rational q divided by x, right? So when before we had 8 and 3, right? 8 and 3 with this map, the point squared, the point on the plane squared. The return value of rho applied to 8 and 3 is the same return value as applied to 1 and 3 over 8, right? In this way, we can interpret this function of the points of natural numbers as a function just on the rational number line, right? We have just one input, but it's a rational number, you know, actually has is composed of two natural numbers, you might say. In this way, we get a function which maps into, I mean, this statement is clear. We plug rational numbers into the function. We get return values that lie on the rational points on the unit circle. So in particular, they are among the points in the rational plane. And just by plugging this in, right? So our function was, where's the expression? So here, this is this thing. We are going to use, for x, we're going to use just 1. This is going to be 1, this is going to be 1. And for y, we're going to use y over x, or we renamed that to t. So this is going to be 1 minus t squared and 2t. And then this thing in rho is also divided by the square of the norm. So this is divided by 1 plus q squared. So this gives us a surjective map to all the rational points. And this function you might be familiar with from like introduction to algebraic geometry, where you see, or you are told that this is indeed like a map that parameterizes with this nice fraction of quadratic polynomials, or linear here in this case, the circle, right? And this is also then this picture. So here you have the this is basically the t-axis, the values for the rational numbers, and the return value, this pair, this point, is exactly these values. And so if you take any rational number here, right, then for an irrational number t, the return value here is just this fraction of quadratic polynomial of this rational number. This is again going to be rational points. You get a point which by construction has norm 1, but it's also a rational point. And this is actually the picture which corresponds to that. So you see that because the rationals are dense here, it's clear that the rational points in U1 are also dense in U1, right? So if you ever implement any computation on your computer that has e to the I something, right? If you work with a computer and implement some element in this representation of the U1 Lie group, then to the finite nature of your computer, you are actually, you're really dealing with an element of SO2Q, you're actually dealing with a rational point here, right? Let's say you have a floating point approximation of this complex number. The floating point approximation, assuming it even fulfills the norm one criteria, like assuming you don't break this, is actually better understood as a rational point on this, on the unit circle. This is also the picture that you see if you look at the at this here. So here it says it explicitly. If you like, our n is y and our m is x, and if you plug that in, you get exactly this thing. And now you see you should understand that as this minus sign comes from basically from the complex multiplication I being squared. So this is x squared minus y squared, and the 2mn on the other side, and this is divided by the norm, and this is how this is forced to be on a unit circle. And so sometimes you might maybe see, if you say inverse trigonometric functions. Let's see if I get to a suitable Wikipedia page quickly here. Okay, so there are also, like, I'm sure this lists a bunch of formulas. Right? You have this sort of formulas, and if you look at the sine and cosine inverted, here, so the arc sine and cosine, these elements here are really just the components of the point, of course, taken apart like into the two sides. So here, of course, you have this point, like given any x, you get a point with x component this thing, y component this thing, and the inverse cosine and sine function takes you to the angle. There's one angle which gives you the point with these two components. And so these two values correspond to the same angle, and as such, they are just two things of the same, like two numbers stemming from the same point, right? This is just the x component, and this is just the y component. And this is how you can kind of understand this relation, where this comes about, right? Here, this is the Pythagorean triple formula. The numerator is Pythagorean triple for A, this Pythagorean triple for B, then this is the Pythagorean triple right hand side C divided out. You get this Lie group element for U1, and that's why the formula holds. I guess that's it for that. Hope you enjoyed that. I made the previous video, right, streaming these Cauchy sequences, because I wanted to show you how you can implement sequence of a rational number, which then in the limit converges to a real number, in the sense that in the Cauchy sense, like this. I don't want to pull out the whole analysis box here, but my point is here that with something like this parameterization, right, you can now easily also find a Cauchy sequence of rational points on U1, which in the limit leaves SO2Q. So say differently. Let's interpret this circle here as U1. We found a way with this formula to find all the rational points on U1. And a priori, it might be hard to like speak of a sequence of rational points on this. But with this formula, what we just have to do is we find a sequence of rational numbers, like let's say a sequence of rational numbers which converge against square root of 2 divided by 2, right? So this is like just a sequence of rational numbers which converges against 0.7, da, 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 which is easy to get by because we have, of course, the series expansion of the square root function. And so the partial sums towards this series expansion of the square root function gives us better and better rational approximations to the square root of 2 over 2. And we can interpret this approximation as a sequence of rational numbers on this axis here, right? They will eventually converge against, let's say, square root of 2 over 2. And so the image point of this sequence under this row function gives us a sequence of rational points then here on the circle whose element, because this will be also a non-rational point, is actually a point which is not rational anymore. So this is a sequence of rational points, a sequence of points on the rational subgroup of U1, which in the limit leaves this rational subgroup and ends up being actually in the Lie group. And so that's how like this dense group of points on a circle is different from a Lie group, because a Lie group is like this manifold object where a sequence of Cauchy points always has a limit on the, assuming it's invertible, also on the inside of the Lie group, which is not the case with these rational points here. Okay, so let's leave it at that. Let's leave it under 1 hour, and wish you a good night.